we are too busy fighting with ourselves. You know, the Pakistani is too busy looking down to the Nigerian. And the Nigerian is too busy looking down at the others. The Arab is too busy thinking he knows all best because he is born in the Arab country. So he says, oh, don't go to that masjid. The Imam is not Arab, so he's from Africa. He's from West Africa. He's from Asia. He's from Hind. I don't pray behind him. Subhanallah. Ya Habib, look at where we are. There's nothing about special about being Arab. Really, there's no, except Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But if you have nothing to do with him, you don't follow his teachings. Let me tell you, even Abu Lahab is an Arab. Abu Jahl was an Arab. It's not just your race that makes you special. What makes you special is not that you are family of any prophet, that you are Sayyid, that you are a Sharif, you are special. Why? Why should you be special? I don't believe in that. I believe unless you follow the teachings, then you are special. Yes, then you are better than me, because I may also follow the teachings, but I don't have the blood of Rasulullah in me. So yes, you are better than me. But if you have the blood of the Prophet, if you are from the same race of the Prophet, same lineage of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you call yourself Sayyid, and you are a Sharif, for example, but you don't follow his teachings, and you disregard his teachings, remember, there was a Prophet of Allah, who's Nuh alayhi salam. Nuh alayhi salam. You are living 14 centuries later, claiming to be the son of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyid, you know? Sayyid, they are sons of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ahlul Bayt. You are coming 1400 years later. And you think that because you are related to the Prophet, you are now more superior than everyone else? Let me tell you, there was a Prophet who was Nuh alayhi salam. He had a son, not 1400 years after, no. Next generation, his own son, Nuh alayhi salam's son. When he disregarded the teachings of his father, Allah said to him, Ya Nuh, laysa min ahlik. Allah said, laysa min ahlik, O my Nuh. Don't worry, he is not from your family. And even though biologically he was. But it Allah said, laysa min ahlik, which means he is deprived from the blessings one can gain when he is your family. Same way. If somebody is Arab, subhanAllah, if you follow the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and you consider all are equal, I have more respect for you. Why? Because you have some nisbah with Rasulullah more than I have, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Similarly, but the problem is, as I said, we Ummah, how can we do these things? SubhanAllah. We are too much busy saying, no, this mosque is there's too many people from Pakistan in this mosque, so I will go to the other mosque. Oh, the best mosque is the one that has more Arabs. SubhanAllah, where are we? The Nigerian will say, no, we don't go to this masjid. Or, I'm giving example because everything is in English. I'd like to listen to Yoruba. I like to listen in my language. And some Pakistanis, subhanAllah, they used to come in the masjid a lot and they stopped. And when they were asked, they said, Sheikh always talks in English. I mean, come on, you're educated. You go outside to shopping, you don't do it in Urdu language, do you? Your children don't know Urdu. And you want the Sheikh to speak Urdu. And you say, Sheikh is not really a Pakistani because he doesn't. SubhanAllah, this is where we are. And we try to, change the ahwal of the Ummah. Same way, what we need to do is, we need to look what our priorities are. I think in Europe, the first priority you have, wallahi, the first priority is your family. Seriously, and this is not, I'm not talking from a social perspective. No, forget that. I'm talking from an Islamic perspective. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, on the day of judgment, listen, you are responsible not for your own good deeds alone, for those that you are made authority of, that you are leading, that is first of all your children, your wife, your children, your family. You are responsible for your family, their deen, their tarbiyah, their education of deen. So, but what we think, what we normally Muslims do, unlike the Jews, for example, what we do is, and some of the things of the Jews, of course, we have anything, any person has a good thing quality, a nation has it, adopt it. It's Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the Prophet went to Hijrah, he came in Medina, he saw the Jews fasting, and he said, why do you fast on the Ashura, on the 10th of Muharram? They said, because of the freedom Moses got from Pharaoh. We got freed on this day. Rasulullah didn't say, oh, antum Yahud, you are Yahud, you are Jews. That's fine, you know, we have nothing to do with it. No, he said, نَحْنُ أُولَى بِمُوسَى مِنْكُمْ. He saw something so common. That was the ethics, Musa alayhi salam. So he said, we are going to adopt this quality of yours. Same way, nowadays, for example, the Jews, they're a small minority. But yet they are very united, isn't it? They're very, very united. I mean, they're a small minority, they rule the world. Why? It's all about unity. It's all about thinking about the greater cause. Our causes are, when we come to Europe, first of all, and I really mean it. Well, first of all, when you come to Europe, and I've been saying this for 10 years, and people at that time, they used to say, no, it's not like that. But now, wallahi, I can see it, it's really like that. You come here, first priority is get my papers right. Residency, let me get my papers right. You get your papers, you get your Irish passport. What is mostly, I'm not talking about 100%, but 99% of the Muslims, what do they do next? Buy a house, build a house back home, have a nice car. What is the third thing? I mean, they are not yet thinking, even until now, they have spent many, many years, 10 years, they're not thinking about we Muslims. It's still about me. I've got my passport, I've got my family got a passport, now I've got a nice car, I've got a Mercedes outside, I've got a very nice house in Lahore, in defense area, you know, and I've got a very nice house here. Okay, I've got a nice business, what next? Not thinking yet about we Muslims. And by the time he's done this, the fourth, you know, these, the house and everything, his children already, they are gone. In the way of they're still with him, but they have no cultural traditions. They have no Islam in them. They have no saqafa in them. They have no ethics in them. They are children. If he says, why do you do so? Why do you do this? They'll say, oh, mind your own business. Dad, mind your own business. What's your problem? Yes, wallahi, this is what's going to happen. So what happens is, then the next thing is, and he's still busy. He doesn't realize. The person doesn't realize his children are gone. What did he do? He didn't achieve anything if his children are gone. But he's still busy. You know, now he's busy with, you know what? Let me make an association and become the president of Pakistani Cultural Society. Let me make a Nigerian Cultural Society. Let me make an Al-Jazair Cultural Society. So I'll be able to sit with the local councillors and in front of everybody, I'll be, you know, everybody, most of my friends who came with me, they've got houses, they've got the passport. Now I must show that I'm better than them. I've achieved more. So now he's busy with trying to be a politician. Still thinking about himself. Still thinking about himself, and he's not thinking about we Muslims. And by the time he becomes that, he's gonna die, because life is only very, very short. He dies and he goes in the grave. What did you bring with you? I got one car, Mercedes. Oh, it's gone. I got Irish passport. Oh, it's gone. I got a nice house in Lahore, defense. It's gone, subhanAllah. And then, oh, I'm too late. Please let me go back and I'll make sure I don't make the mistake again. No, you don't get the chance. You don't get a chance anymore. This is why, you know, before it's too late, start now. That think about the Ummah. Wallahi, those people that think about the Ummah, even if they, for example, individually, they are not really, no, they make some mistakes, they miss a prayer, for example, or they sometimes make a mistake. Think about the greater cause, the society, and you work for them. What happens is Allah will compensate and He will reward you. I mean, you all know about the hadith of this prostitute. Hadith about the prostitute. You know about this prostitute of Bani Israel? She was a prostitute. She used to sell her body. No dignity, no self-respect. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informed the Sahaba, when she went in front of Allah, in the court of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the angels, accept her in Jannah. I mean, bring her to paradise. And the Sahaba went, Ya Rasulullah, a prostitute? How come Allah sent her to paradise? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, not only was he fahisha, the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said she didn't pray. She believed in Allah, but she never prayed. She was not pure. She was all the time in the impurity. Yet Allah said, go in Jannah. Why? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, she did one thing, Allah liked it. And that is the message. That do something for the society. Imagine if you do something for animals, this lady, for an animal, I like her so much that look at her. She doesn't listen to me, but she cares for my creation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you can go to Jannah. I mean, that's, this is Islam. So when we are here, our responsibility is to think about the society, to think about us, the Muslims, the nation. We are not only creation of Allah, we are at the same time Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imagine when someone thinks about an animal, Allah becomes so merciful, wallahi. Imagine when someone does something for the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Habib, the beloved messenger of Allah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When you do something for the Ummah, imagine how pleased Allah becomes, how merciful He becomes. When His mercy is this, He forgives a prostitute because she... Imagine if somebody does something for the Ummah, khair, anything beneficial, what reward he will get, wallahi, it's unimaginable. So think like this now, inshallah.